Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. Today is our monthly Q&A. Before we get to the questions, I would like to acknowledge Dingo Smith and of course many others in the community for their interest in the tea I drink. Starting with today's video, we will have a new section called High on Tea. Before the main topic in every video, where I will talk about the tea I'm drinking along with some interesting information related to it. I'm sure you all will enjoy getting high on tea, pun fully intended. Today's tea is Bai Mu Dan O White Peony. It is a white tea commonly found in Fuding city of Fujian province. The real Bai Mu Dan tea is from that region only. This tea has at least 10 years old. By the way, to white tea, older is better. Traditionally, there is the proverb about white tea. 一年茶，三年药，七年宝. It is the tea in the first year, it is the medicine in the third year, and it is a treasure when reaches 7 years old. White tea is slightly oxidized through a unique processing procedure. White tea is loaded with polyphenols and it strengthens the immune system, weight control, and other health benefits depending on its age. The best water temperature for white tea is 95 to 100 degrees. To have a better experience, you can boil the tea for a couple of minutes. You can drink this tea at any time of the day, but if you are concerned about sleeping issues, then do not drink this tea 4 hours before bedtime. The color of white tea is very clear, and the common flavors include fresh, fruity, melon, and so on. Now, let's take a quick look at questions for today. First question from Thomas Hudchek, conversation to doctors and teachers in old China. Second, from Darkwing Duke. First, Qing Dynasty and the martial art. Third question from Darkwing Duke, Wudang and other mountain styles. Fourth question from Caesar Excellente, Bao Jian. Fifth question from Kinetic Advent, Qigong versus Neigong. Sixth from Robin and Ruth, Peng Jin versus Hua Jin. Seventh from Timothy Rude, first, Tai Chi, small frame versus big frame, and eighth from Timothy Root, Tai Chi, Zhao Bao style. Ninth question from Timothy Root, martial art form and function. Tenth question from body health Tai Chi, functional fitness and weapons training. 11th question from Shi Wan, Xing Yi spear training and power generation. 12th question from Federico Din, Xing Yi 13 spears. 13 questions from Dong Man Fa Jin in other styles. So, let's get started. Mr. Thomas Hudchek asked if it is true that in old China, the medical doctor and the martial art teachers only got paid if the students were successful or if the clients stayed healthy. Thank you, Mr. Hudchek, for a very interesting question. It is not the first time I'm hearing about this. A couple years ago, a student of mine also mentioned it. I have to tell you that there was no such tradition. No matter old or modern times, medical doctors were paid immediately, as is the case around the world today. As for martial art teachers only getting paid on their students' success, well, that never happened either. Why would a martial art teacher invest time and energy with conditional compensation depending on the student's success? In China, there is the popular proverb, quote, 师傅领进门，修行在个人, end quote. Translation, your teacher only brings you to enter the door, but the achievement will depend on yourself, which will remind most of you of a famous quote by Morpheus to Neo. Also, a teacher's reputation depends on his own practice and not the practice of students. Of course, great students were a strong indication of the teacher's teaching ability, but it was not the most important factor in the old days. So, both of those stories have no basis in reality. I hope I answered your questions, Mr. Hudacek. Let's move on to the next one. Darkwing Duke asks two history and culture-related questions. Let me answer them one by one. He first asks if there were conflicts between internal martial artists and southern martial artists since the former were hired by the Qing Dynasty while the latter wanted to restore the Ming Dynasty. Thank you, Darkwing Duke. This is a very interesting question. The Ming Dynasty, which lasted from 1368 to 1644, was considered the last dynasty created by the majority Han people. The Qing Dynasty, which lasted from 1636 to 1912, was created by the Manchu minority and is considered the last dynasty in the imperial history of China. After the Qing government took over China, many groups, especially during the early period and also close to the end of the Qing dynasty, claimed Fan Qing Fu Ming, or overthrow the Qing dynasty and restore the Ming dynasty. This campaign not only happened in China, but also in many other countries such as Japan, USA, and even Canada as well, since many people who had left China developed their anti-Qing movement overseas. As long as there were Chinese Han people, there were many groups that supported this claim. Especially in the beginning of the Qing Dynasty, many groups in the south of China organized themselves and tried to overthrow the Qing government. There were many reasons for it. A major one being that those areas were far from the capital of the Qing Dynasty and thus had more opportunities to fight against the Qing government. And of course, many southern martial artists got involved in it. But Xing Yi, Tai Chi, Ba Gua, and Ba Ji, like you mentioned in your question, were developed and popularized first in the north, close to the capital of the Qing dynasty. There might have been many opportunities for martial artists from both of the north and the south to fight each other in isolated individual combats, but not organized group combat. Even in the south, for example, Feng Daode, a Shaolin monk who later became a Wudang priest, was involved in a conflict with the anti-Qing groups in the south. But that short-lived conflict only occurred among Southern Shaolin as Feng Daode was considered a Southern Shaolin practitioner. The famous Xing Yi, Tai Chi, Ba Gua, and Ba Ji practitioners were in North China. Most of them did not get involved in the anti-Qing campaigns. Most of those groups were claimed to overthrow the Qing dynasty and restore the Ming dynasty did not actually aim to restore the Ming dynasty. They only aimed to overthrow the Qing dynasty in order to spread their own influence and power. This is why, towards the end of the Qing dynasty, the slogan was shortened to overthrow the Qing dynasty, with no mention of restoring the Ming dynasty anymore. A perfect example of dirty politics. So, to answer your first question, there was no official compact between the southern and the northern selves in the Qing dynasty, no matter what claim or slogan they used. His second question is about myth and Wu Xia mentioning many mountains such as Wudang, Emei, Hua, and Qingcheng along with their own martial art styles and if they have a long history. Yes, there are many styles named after different mountains as you mentioned in your question, including Emei, Hua, Qingcheng, and so on. Actually, using the name of a mountain is just a convenience for people to name a style. But think about this. Historically speaking, how many popular martial art styles originated on a mountain? Actually, not many, and especially none of the three internal styles. Xing Yi, Tai Chi, Ba Gua, and also Ba Ji and many other styles have nothing at all to do with the mountains. Wuxia movies make mountains famous and these mountains end up become tourist traps. Also, martial artists should test and develop their practice in populated areas like cities and not in a mountain. Most martial artists cannot improve their skills by fighting with monkeys on a mountain or by dreaming about snakes fighting cranes. Dark Wind Duke, I hope that answers both your questions. Let's move on to the next one. Caesar Aslante asked about a combined term for shoulder blade and upper arm. Thank you, Caesar, for this question. Yes, the term you are looking for is Bao Jian. Bao means embrace, while Jian means shoulders. Bao Jian has multiple meanings in the context of martial arts. It can be a martial art movement in which the arms embrace your own or your opponent's shoulders. It can also be used to describe a shoulder and back posture. Shoulders extend forward, making the chest hollow, helping to send the force from the back to the arms in self-defense. I hope I have answered your question, Caesar. Let's move on to the next one. Kinetic Advent asked about the differences between Nei Gong and Qi Gong. If I remember well, I have talked about this topic before. Briefly speaking, Nei Gong means internal practice, while Qi Gong is a specific practice. Nei Gong is usually used in the martial art community, while Qi Gong is a term for general practice. Martial Qi Gong, a specific Qi Gong style with other practices, aims to improve Nei Gong. Nei Gong can be improved through the practice of martial Qi Gong. So, Nei Gong describes the result of a Qi Gong practice, while Qi Gong is the means to improve Nei Gong. I hope that answers the question, Kinetic Advent. Let's move on to the next one. Ruben Andrews asks about the differences between Peng Jin and Hua Jin and their effectiveness. Thank you, Robin. Great question indeed. Let me first explain Peng Jin and Hua Jin. Peng Jin, as the first of eight Tai Chi energies, means expanding motion and expanding energy. In other words, in Tai Chi practice, the entire body, including the arms, palms, and the head, should maintain an expanding motion or energy. So, Peng Jin is the type of Tai Chi energy. I have a video titled Tai Chi and its 8 gate forces, from theory to practice. Talking about Peng Jin and its practice, link is in the description. Now, let's talk about Hua Jin. Hua Jin has multiple meanings, including a type of energy used to neutralize the opponent's attack or a practice level that mainly focuses on the neutralization of incoming attacks. In other words, Hua Jin is more about the nature of a type of energy that utilizes skills to avoid direct confronting the opponent's attack and instead redirecting it. It can also be understood as the general self-defense strategy instead of a specific technique. So, Peng Jin and Hua Jin are two different topics and are used to describe two different contexts. Peng Jin is used in the context of technique, while Hua Jin is used in the context of strategy. Thus, both Chen style and Wu style equally emphasizes Peng Jin as well as Hua Jin. Ruben, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next one. Timothy Root asks 3 Tai Chi questions. Let me get to them one by one. He first asks about the difference between large frame and small frame. Thank you, Timothy. I have a video introducing Tai Chi history, including both big frame and small frame Tai Chi. Nonetheless, this is a great question and I'd like to give a brief answer here. My research so far indicates that the original Chen style Tai Chi is the small frame Tai Chi. The big frame Tai Chi was modified by Chen Changxing, part of the 6th generation of Chen style Tai Chi, and also one of Yang Lu Chan's Tai Chi teachers. Now, you may wonder, why big frame Chen style is a lot more popular compared to small frame Chen style? Well, we can thank some famous Tai Chi masters, including Chen Fa Ke, Chen Zhao Kui, Chen Zhao Pi, and others for this phenomenon. Chen style became popular and well-known after Chen Fa Ke moved to Beijing. This is based on historical facts. However, small frame Chen style is still popular in some regions of China, including the Chen village and some other cities such as Xi'an. It is worth noting that the term small frame is different from the term small circle. Small frame means a specific Chen style, while small circle is an approach or a result of a long-term practice, which makes the circle smaller and subtler. Any type of Chen style, no matter big frame or small frame, should eventually result in a small and subtle circle. So, if someone claims their Tai Chi to be a small circle Tai Chi, they were neither lied to or they are lying to you. Timothy also asked about the Zhao Bao style Tai Chi. Zhao Bao is the name of the town next to Chen village. For many years now, Zhao Bao and Chen village have argued with each other over the original birthplace of Tai Chi. I would rather avoid discussing this issue any further. So let's stop here. By the way, Zhao Bao style also contains big frame as well as small frame practice. Timothy finally asks if form implies function in terms of martial effectiveness. Another great question. Short answer, yes. In Chinese martial arts, form is the medium of techniques. However, those forms should be practiced intentionally in order to carry out martial functions. In other words, if a form is just practiced as the combination of movements without any analysis of its applications, then it becomes merely an empty form. Let me give you an example. A martial form is just like this cup. An intended martial application is the tea in the cup. A teacup without the tea is just a cup. Only when it is used to serve tea does it become a teacup. So, a form without application is a cup without the tea. Timothy, I hope that answers the questions. Let's move on to the next one. Body Health Tai Chi asks about training with martial art weapons, especially in public. Thank you, Body Health Tai Chi. I learned a couple of good English words from your question. I do not have any experience with modern sports equipment, but I have a decade's worth of training experience with traditional martial art weapons such as spear, long pole, saber, and others. In China, until the recent past, everyone could practice any weapon in public, but a few years ago, I heard that it was not encouraged to practice some martial art weapons in public. In Canada, we are not allowed to do so either. For example, many years ago, soon after moving to a new neighborhood, my neighbor called the police since they saw me practicing with weapons in my own backyard. After informing the police that I was practicing in my own backyard without bothering anyone else, the police left. That was the first and the last time this incident occurred with me. That is why I love Canada so much. Regarding your mention of the Guandao, yes, it is simply inconvenient to practice Guandao in public, but social norms cannot change the fact that the practice of some martial art weapons such as spear and Guandao is great for improving traditional martial art skills. Body Health Tai Chi, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next one. Shivan asks if spear or pole shaking is essential for power generation in Xingyi as well as the right stage at which to practice it. Thank you, Shivan. This is a very good question. Spear training is an unavoidable part of training for any serious Xingyi practitioner. With regards to pole shaking in particular, it is useful, but its benefits can also be achieved through spear training. So, in my opinion, spear training is more suitable than pole shaking training in Xingyi. Speaking of alternative methods, the three classic spear movements, Beng, Kou, Zha, are the most important practices. I always teach the spear to my students after a year of training. And if they have a prior training background, I begin teaching the spear even earlier. With regard to the size and weight of a pole or spear, as long as you can handle it without any serious issues, you are good to go. Normally, a heavier pole or spear is a lot more challenging, but also provides greater benefits. Some people also use a metal spear in training. That may be okay for training strength, but may not be suitable for other skills. I hope I have answered your question, Shivan. Let's move on to the next one. Federica Gaudin asks about the 13 spear practice in Xingyi. Thank you, Fred. This may be a very short question, but it requires a lot of discussion. Well, I have yet to introduce weapons practice in the lecture series. I'd still like to briefly talk about this topic in today's video. Martial weapons, especially the spear, used to form the most important training content in the Chinese military and martial art practice. Unfortunately, many modern martial artists cannot practice weapons very well, and due to the development of societal norms over time, weapon practice has become a lot less convenient. The incident I shared with you earlier in today's video perfectly reflects this situation. If you are not concerned with these factors, I highly recommend martial artists practice at least a couple of weapons. Speaking from personal training and teaching experience, weapons training provides some unique benefits which simply cannot be achieved through bare hand training. Now, let's talk about the 13 spears. 13 spears used to be a popular spear practice in Xing Yi. It consists of 13 postures chosen from traditional spear practice. So, to understand the 13 spear better, we first need to understand the history of Chinese spear training. As mentioned in many prior videos, the spear is the king of Chinese weapons, and even today, training the spear can greatly improve your bare hand skills. Traditionally, in Chinese military and martial history, there were a few spear systems named after family names or places such as Yang family, Sha family, Shi family, Ma family, and Shaolin, among many others. Each system has a different number of key postures. For example, 24 postures of the Ma family spear, 16 postures of the Cheng family spear, and so on. There are so many spear postures, and all of them are very valuable in martial training. I will talk more about spear training in the future. By the way, the principle of a spear training is the same as bare hand training. There are different postures for different objectives, and there is no unified posture for any style. Some people mistakenly use the specific posture to justify their understanding of bare hand practice, which is totally wrong. Any style and any posture should be dynamic and alive. If your movement is stiff on account of a wrong posture, no matter what weapon you use to justify your wrong posture, it will still remain a wrong posture. Right, I hope I have answered your question. Now, let's look at the final question for today. Dong Men asks if Fa Jin can be utilized in external style as well as combat sports like boxing or MMA. Dong Men, thank you for your great questions. Fa Jin can be utilized in any style of martial art. However, internal styles really emphasize Fa Jin training, especially Xing Yi, which is considered a Fa Jin-oriented style. Back when I was a child, Fa Jin used to be a very popular term and practice in the community. But things have changed in the last couple of decades in China. Fa Jin, the concept as well as the practice, has gradually declined in popularity, which is very unfortunate. Upon noticing this situation, I published many articles and videos detailing Fa Jin, which fortunately has received a lot of support in the community. Fa Jin is not only essential for combat skill, but also great for health. If you teach martial art but you cannot execute Fa Jin, that is perfectly fine because it only reflects your extent of practice. But that's no excuse for you to deny the value of Fa Jin practice. Martial art training needs power, which is in turn needs both speed and force, which are the elements of Fa Jin practice and should not be neglected. So, to answer your question, Fa Jin should be utilized in any Chinese martial art style, no matter internal, external, or anything else. Speaking of boxing, MMA, and other combat sports, I'm not the right person to comment on them. As far as I can tell, they should also have a similar speed and force training, possibly under different names. Since boxing and MMA practitioners also need to utilize speed and force. Dong, I hope I have answered your questions. That brings us to the end of today's video. I hope you found my answers helpful. Please do not hesitate to ask follow-up questions should you have any. Thank you for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.